Welcome back, students. This is the second part of Chapter 1, Advanced Web Designing. Students, we've already learned in Part 1 video HTML5 Advanced Input Elements, Input Restrictions, and Meta Tag. Now, we are going to learn in this video CSS syntax, CSS properties, types of CSS, CSS selectors, positioning in CSS, float and display property. CSS stands for cascading style sheets. CSS describes how HTML elements are to be displayed on screen, paper, or in other media. So what is CSS? CSS is a language for describing the presentation of web pages, including color, layout, and fonts. CSS allows web designers, developers to make website unique and attractive. So what is the need of CSS? CSS saves a lot of work. How? Now, HTML was created to describe the content of a web page, and if you keep formatting each element in the web page, it's a tedious task. Instead, using CSS, we can change one element or multiple elements in a web page altogether. And CSS can control the layout of multiple web pages all at once. Also, CSS allows you to control the look and feel of several pages by changing a single source. CSS syntax, the rule of writing CSS. CSS rule set contains two things. The first one is a selector and the second one is a declaration block. We'll see how it is written. Here, H1 braces open, color, colon, yellow, braces closed. Let's see what they are. The first one is a selector, which is pointing to H1. So what is a selector? The selector indicates the HTML element you want to style. So here I want to give a styling to H1, which is the highest level heading, a tag, or an element. You can use any tag here. It can be H1, body, image, anchor, or paragraph. But when we are writing the tag as a selector, we will not write the ankle bracket here. So now H1 is my selector. Now how do I write the declaration block? After H1, you open the braces and then you mention the property, colon, and mention the value, close the braces. So here the property is color, you mention the colon here, and value is yellow. So the color and yellow, that is a property and value, they are separated with a colon. The entire thing is a declaration block. So right now in this declaration block, there is only one property and value. If you want, you can add more properties in this declaration block. So this H1 will have a color yellow. So let's see, if you want to add more properties, how will you do it? Here in H1, the braces open, the color colon red. So H1 is a selector. Color is a property, colon, red is the value. Now, if I want to add one more property to it, I have to add a semicolon, then I will write the property. Here in this property, there are two words, so background hyphen color, it's mentioned. After that, a colon, and yellow is the value. And close the braces. So this H1 got two properties. The first one is a color, and the second one was a background color. So this H1 will have a text color red with a background color yellow. So how do we write a CSS syntax? We need a selector. It can be any tag. You open the braces. In the declaration block, you will mention the property and a value separated by a colon. If you want to add more properties, it is separated with a semicolon. So students, before going to the types of CSS and solving programs, we will be learning CSS properties and values now. Let's see various properties and values used in CSS. Property uses value, example, and output. First property is color. It changes the color of the text, that is, it sets the text color of an element. You can mention the color name in the value. So you can see the example H1 braces open, color, colon, crimson, and braces close. So here H1 is the selector and color is a property and crimson is the value. That I want to change the text color of H1 to crimson. So you can see the output, this has been changed into crimson color. So whichever color you want, you can mention in the value here. Next property is background color, two words, background hyphen color. To set the background color in your web page, that is, it sets a background color of an element. You can mention the color name in the value. So here, body is the selector, braces open, background color the property, colon, and yellow is the value, braces close. So here, I want to change the body. The entire body color should be in yellow. So you can see background color is yellow. So that is the text I have mentioned in my web page, and the background color is yellow. Font weight, two words here. That is font hyphen weight. This is how you have to mention the property. Used to bold text. The values used are, you can either write bold or you can write values from 100 to 900. According to the requirement, you can select the value. Now, this font weight, this property sets how thick or thin the characters in text should be displayed. So here B, font weight 700. So I want my text of my paragraph to be 700. So P is for paragraph, that is, it's my selector, the tag, font weight is a property, and 700 is a value. So you can see the output, the font weight will look like this. And the normal font, this is the normal font in which I haven't given any font weight. So this is the font weight with 700, the output like this. The next property is font style, two words, hyphen in between, font hyphen style. It is used to italicize text, that is, to set different font style for a text. That is, the value you can give is normal, italic, or oblique. So I have given a selector, font style, normal. P is my selector, font style my property, normal is my value. The first one I've given normal value, the second one italic is my value, and the third one oblique. So you can see the output, the normal font will look like this. The italic, you can see the slanting version here, and font style in oblique. So you can see both of them looks slightly slanted. Okay, now there's a subtle difference between them, that is, italic font are generally cursive in nature and use less horizontal space, while oblique are just sloped version of the regular font face. The next is font family, two words, font hyphen family. Now it specifies the font for an element, that is, this is used to control the fonts. You can give the font name as a value. So the value, it can be Times New Roman, it can be Georgia, Arial, Arial Black, Cursive, anything. So you have to mention the selector, the property, and the value according to the font you need. So P is the selector here, font family property. The first one, Arial, is the value. In the second one, Times New Roman, it's a value here. You can see the output will look like this. The next property is font size, two words here, font hyphen size. This property allows you to control the size of the font. That is, it sets the size of the text. The text value you can mention, and the unit it is specified here. The unit is px, it's for pixels, in, it's for inches, mm for millimeter, cm for centimeter, pt for point. Now, px means pixel, that is picture element, a single dot in an image. The greater the number of pixels, the better the quality of the picture. Now, the rest of the inch, millimeter, centimeter, the physical measurement, you already know what it is. And PT. So, this user unit is a unit of length used to measure height of a font. Now, 1 inch is equal to 96 pixels, or 1 inch is equal to 72 point. So, you can choose any of these units. Especially for screen, PX is the best, pixel is the best, and for the printer, printing purposes, PT is the best. Now, P, this is my selector, font size, my property. I have mentioned, along with the unit, I have to mention the value, that's 10 pixels I have mentioned. And the second one I've mentioned, 15 pixels, and the third one's 20 pixels. Now, see the difference here, the output. We can see the font size, the size, the 10 pixels, it is getting bigger, 15 pixels. See, it's growing more for 20 pixels. The next property, text decoration. Text decoration, two words. There's a hyphen in between that. So text decoration property is used to set or remove decorations from the text. Uses, this property is used to add underline, overstrike, strike through marks to remove underlines from links. The values are underline, overline, line through, none. So if I give an underline value, what happens? It gives an underline to the text. If I use overline, there is a line over the text. This is what you get when you give overline. Now, if I give line through, it gives me a line through it, that is through the text, or strike through the text. None, it is used to remove underline from links. See in the example, the first one got a paragraph. This is a selector P, text decoration, my property, and the value is underline. You can see the output. This text decoration is my text and I've got an underline. The next one, P, text decoration overline. So see, the text is text decoration. I got a line over it. P, text decoration line through. So my text is text decoration. I got a line through it. Next is A, which is for an anchor tag to create a link. Text decoration none. It means that here I've got a link to Mumbai University webpage. Usually on the webpage, if you see a link, you will see an underline to it. I don't want this underline to be visible. So what I do, I write this property text decoration with the value none. So this underline is removed. Next is text align property, text hyphen align. So text align property specifies the horizontal alignment of text in an element. This property is used to control the horizontal alignment of any block level text that are paragraphs, tables and other elements. The values are left, center, right, justify. If I give the value as left, it aligns the text to the left hand side. If it is center, it aligns the text to the center. If it is right, it aligns the text to the right. If the value is justified, then it stretches the lines so that each line has equal width like in newspapers and magazines. You can see the example P, which is a selector, text align, the property text hyphen align, value is left. See the output. This is my text. Text align left is on the left hand side. P, text align center, it is in the center. P, text align right, it is on the right side. P, text align justify, it looks like this. Now, if you want to see the difference between the text align left and justify, see, I can show you. This is what it looks like. See that left align text and the justify text. In the case of left align, left means the left edge of the text is aligned. In the case of justified, it means that both the left edge and the right edge of the text is aligned. So in this case, both the edges are aligned. In this case, only the left is aligned. See how the words are ending over here and how the words, the letters, these things are ending over here. So this is what the difference between left aligned and justified. Now letter spacing property, letter hyphen spacing. This property increases or decreases the space between characters in a text. This helps in controlling the horizontal spacing between characters of text. The values and the units you have to use along with that, px, pixel, inches, millimeter, centimeter, point. Here p is the selector, letter spacing my property, 5 point. Here the unit given is pt and 5 is the value. See the output. The text I have written is got 5 points. See the spacing in between these letters. Now here, P, letter spacing 15 point, 15 value and PT is the unit. See the spacing between the output here. The text has got 15 point. The spacing between is 15 point. The next property is padding. This property is used when you want to add padding, blank spaces around the content of an element. That is, padding property are used to generate spaces around an element content inside of any defined border. So here, the unit given is pixel. See the example, P, which is a selector, padding is my property, 30 is the value, px is the unit given for it. Here, in the output, I've given God. This God, I haven't given any padding for this text. Okay, so it is starting, there is no blank spaces in the container. So here, I've given a border for this.
can see the background color yellow. I've given a padding of 30 pixels. So from top 30 pixels, from right 30 pixels, from bottom 30 pixels, from the left 30 pixels. All four sides 30 pixels blank spaces should be seen for this text in this container. This is how you mention padding. Border, the next property. This property adds a border to a web page element. This border property specifies what kind of border style you need for the element. The values you can give are solid, double, groove, ridge, inset, outset, dotted or dashed. Now for the example, B is a selector, border is a property, solid is a value here, solid, double, dotted, dashed. See the output. I've got the text as God. Cut on four sides. I've got a solid border from top, right, bottom, left. I've got a solid border here. This is a double border. This is with dotted border. This is dash border. We have groove, ridge, inset and outset. This output you can see. In the case of groove, it's a 3D groove border what you get if you give groove as the value. In the case of ridge, it gives you 3D rigid border. In the case of inset, it gives you 3D inset border. In the case of outset, it gives you 3D outset border. You can use border color also for this to see the difference. The next property is margin left. Margin left property sets a margin area on the left side of the element. So this property sets a margin for an element on the left side. So here the value you can mention along with the units. You can use pixels, point or centimeter. H1 margin left 15 pixel. H1 is the selector. Margin left, margin hyphen left, two words. It's a property, 15 pixels. So you can see God is love. This is the first text in which there is no margin. And for B kind, I've given a margin of 15 pixels. You can see the margin here. This is 15 pixels. Next property is background image. Background hyphen image. To set an image as the background of your web page. So this background image property, you can use it for any element. You can use it for body or H1. Along with that, you have to mention the URL, that is X, where X is the path of the image. Here for the body, I'm going to give so body background image, background hyphen image, colon. So this is a property, body is the selector, URL is the value, and parenthesis. Inside the parenthesis, you have to mention the path of the image, close the parenthesis, then the braces. So I've got the body with the background as rose JPG, and H1 I have written background image. We have seen the properties and values. Now we'll go to the types of CSS. The three types of CSS are inline CSS, internal CSS, external CSS. We'll learn these one by one. The first type of CSS, inline CSS. An inline CSS is used to apply a unique style to a single HTML element. An inline CSS uses the style attribute of an HTML element. So how inline CSS is done, this we'll see. So you have to remember two things. The first thing, we are using the attribute style with the element. The second one, the style attribute along with the property and value is given in the start tag of the element you wish to give style. So we'll see with an example. I have an HTML5 program, the title is brg1. In the body, I have H1 and a paragraph. H1 is the highest level heading and I have a paragraph. This H1, I've written, I want inline CSS to be displayed in H1. Along with that, I want to give few styling for this H1. First, I want it to be color red and I want the background color to be sky blue. So I'm going to use an inline CSS. Inline means along with this tag. Here, the H1 tag, along with the H1 tag, I have used an attribute called style. Here, style equal to, there is no braces here because I'm not using a tag here. Here, tag is H1. Along with that, there is an attribute called style. So, style equal to, and in double quotes, I have to mention the color, which is a property, and red, which is a value. So first property and value. I have one more property which is background color, and the value is sky blue. So two properties separated with semicolon, and property and value separated with colon. So this inline CSS will be of color red and the background color will be sky blue. So this is how you write an inline CSS here in H1. Now I have one more paragraph. The paragraph has got two lines here. So I want this to be a font weight 500 and the font style, it should be italic. So how do I write it? So paragraph, along with that you use the attribute called style equal to, in double quotes you mention the property and value. So the first property is font weight, font hyphen weight 500 is a value, semicolon, font hyphen style italic is a value. Now we'll see the output. The output, you can see the first H1 inline CSS, it is red in color as mentioned here, and the background color is sky blue. I have a paragraph with two lines mentioned here. This, the font weight is 500 and the style here is italic. The font weight means how thick this particular text should be. That is, the I've given as 500 and it is italic. So this is how you give an inline CSS. You have to use a style attribute along with the tag. No braces, in double quotes, the entire thing you have to mention in the start tag only. The next type of CSS is internal CSS or embedded style sheet. This is used to define a style for a single HTML page. It is written inside the style tag within head section of HTML. So what do we need to create an internal CSS? We need a tag called style. And where do we place it? We place it inside the head section. Now we'll see it with an example. So this is an HTML5 program brg2. Now here we see I've opened the head section and I haven't closed it. I've closed it over here. Okay. Now I have a style tag. So we have to use a style tag. This style tag, it's a container tag. You have to close it here before the head. It's placed inside the head section of HTML. So inside the style, I have to place the element, whichever element I want to give styling. So that element I will use as a selector. So here you can see the body. The body, I have H1, and H1 is internal CSS. So I want this internal CSS text to be of font Algerian, and it should be underlined and it should be of color green. So this is the H1 tag. So I want to give styling for this text. So how do I write it? So inside the style, I will write this H1 tag. So as a selector, when we write it as a selector, we don't use the ample bracket. You will write H1 braces open, the block declaration starts. That is, the first is the property. So I want font family. Then I'll mention Algerian is the value. The next property, text decoration, the value is underlined. The third property is color and it is green. So three properties I've mentioned in H1 for the selector. Okay. Now for H2, I've mentioned embedded style sheet. Now I want a different styling for H2. For H2, I want a border groove and I want padding and I want a background color pink and I want a width of 50%. So how do I give it? So H2, the tag, as a selector, I'll write H2 braces open, border is a property, I give the value groove, padding, I give the value 25 pixels padding, and background color, I mention as pink, and the width I give 50%. Now the third one, I've got a paragraph. This paragraph, I want it to be aligned to the left and I want a font size of 15 pixels. So this paragraph, as a selector P, how do I mention it? I'll write P, braces open, font size 15 pixels, text align left. So we have already learned the properties and values. We have already learned the selectors and the block declaration, how it is done. So just see the property and the value separated by colon. Two properties. Here in this case, you have three properties. The properties are separated with semicolon. So we'll see the output here, internal CSS. It should be H1. So what all styling I've mentioned for H1? I've mentioned it should be Algerian. It is Algerian. It should be underlined. Here it is underlined. And it is green in color. So whichever styling I want, I've mentioned it in the style in H1 as a selector. Now the second, I've asked for H2 embedded style sheet or embedded style sheet. I've got a 3D group border. So this is what I got, group border. I've got a padding of 25 pixels I got, and the background color is pink, and a width of 50%. This is 50%. Now, third one, I've got a paragraph. This paragraph, it's aligned to the left. It's mentioned here, text aligned left, and the font size is 15 pixels. So this is how you mention internal CSS. We have to use a style tag, and this style tag is placed inside the head section, and whichever elements you want to give the styling, that element will use as a selector and provide the property and value. The third type of CSS is external CSS. An external style sheet is used to define the style for many HTML pages. It uses link tag and should be put inside the head section. So in the previous slide, when we studied internal CSS, we have used a tag called style tag, and this we put it inside the head section. Here we use link tag, and this is put inside the head section. So link tag has attributes such as rel, href and type. So what is link tag? So link tag is an empty tag, and it defines a relationship between the current document and an external resource. So what is rel? Rel, it's a relationship, and we have to use the value style sheet. href is hypertext reference, and href is a URL you have to mention. You specify the location of the link document. And type, you have to mention type equal to text bar CSS. It specifies the type of the link document. Now, in the external style sheet, it can be written in any text editor and saved with .css extension. This means that whatever selector we are going to use, whatever styling we are going to give, those selectors will not be writing in your HTML document. It will be writing in a separate file and written in any text editor, and will be saving with an extension .css. External CSS file cannot contain an HTML tags. That is, you will be writing the selectors and the block declaration in a separate text editor, in a separate file. And this file, it will not contain any HTML tags, that is HTML, head, title, body. These tags will not be there. Only the selector and the declaration block you will find inside that file. Now we'll see with an example. Here, this is how you write link rel, the relationship, equal to style sheet, type equal to text bar CSS, href, and you have to provide the URL. What is the name of the CSS file you've created that you provided, and this entire tag with the attributes you will mention in your HTML document. We'll see it with an example. Here, HTML5 program, the title is brg3. You can see the head is opening here, and I've closed it over here. Inside this, I have used this tag called link. This is a link tag, which is an empty tag. It contains three attributes. The first one is the relationship, which is style sheet value. Second, type, the value, text bar CSS. Third, href, and I've given the file, the URL is mystyle.css. So this mystyle.css will contain all the styling for this particular web page. Now here in the body, I've mentioned H1. My H1 is external CSS. So I have a particular styling for H1. Even I've got a particular styling for my paragraph. But these stylings are not mentioned here in the head section. In the head section, I have given only the path, the link to that particular file. And in the file, you will see all the selector and the block declaration. You can see I want my external CSS to be of color indigo.
letter spacing and with the background color code. So you can see here I have mentioned href equal to mystyle.css. So if I opened a text editor, in that text editor I have written this selector h1 and one more selector p paragraph, and I've mentioned in the block decoration the various properties and values for this particular web page, and this I have saved as mystyle.css. So now in h1 should have color indigo. Color is a property, indigo is a value, letter spacing property, 5 pixel is the value, background color is a property, gold is the color which I require, and my paragraph should be margin left, it should be margin should be 25 pixels, and the border should be inset, that is 3D inset border I require, and I need a width of 25%. The entire thing I put inside mystyle.css, and I have attached this file using the link tag. Now we'll see the output. The output is external CSS. Here external CSS, this is the h1, and the styling I have mentioned in this file. This file I have attached with this tag. So I got the styling here, and this paragraph, the entire paragraph, I see that I've got a border inset, and the width is 25% and the margin is 25 pixels. So using external CSS, you can create a file and which is saved with an extension .css, and we can use this for n number of web pages. So in that way, see, you have mentioned at the first point, an external style sheet is used to define the style for many HTML pages. So one CSS, if I create, I can use this for n number of web pages. Next, we'll solve a program. Write HTML code to display a text HSC board 2021 having font size 28, font color blue with an overline using an inline CSS. Okay, so here the HTML5 program, the title is brg4. It's an inline CSS. Inline CSS means you have to use it along with the tag. So in the body, the text they said is HSC board 2021. So I'll use it as an h1. So h1, I will use style as an attribute equal to the font size which is required is 28. So font size 28, color blue to make the text color blue, color property blue is the value, with an overline. To get an overline, we have to use the property text decoration. Overline is the value. You'll mention HSC board 2021, close h1. Now we'll see the output. This is the output what you will get. HSC board 2021 in blue color, font size is 28, and we have an overline. We have a line above the text. The next program to solve. Write HTML code to display a text, advanced web designing in italic, having a background color pink aligned to the center with a rich border using an internal CSS. So using an internal CSS, you have to solve this program. So we'll solve it. See, the title of the program is brg5. Here, since it's an internal CSS, we have to use tag called style, which we have to place inside the head tag. And now the text to be displayed is advanced web designing. So I'll mention h1. Advanced web designing. So I have to provide a styling for this. The styling they asked for is it should be in italic. So h1 I have to write as a selector h1, braces open, font style is a property and italic is a value, having a background color pink. So background color is a property and pink is a value, aligned to the center, that is text align, it's a property and center is a value, with a rich border. Border, rich, mention it, everything inside the braces, braces closed over here. You can provide it in a single line using the semicolon. The properties are separated with semicolon, property and value is separated with colon. Now we can see the output. The output, advanced web designing, it is in the center of the page. It is with rich border, it's a 3D rich border, and it is italic, and the background color is pink. The next program, write HTML code using external CSS to display a text, cascading style sheets, a paragraph, and a link to functional World Wide Web. The text should be underlined and green in color. The paragraph should have an Arial black font and a margin of 30 pixels. The link should be without underline with an outside border and a padding around it. So we have to create this using an external CSS. Okay, now for external CSS, what do you have to do? Whatever the content, the text, the cascading style sheet, the paragraph, the link, everything you will prepare inside the HTML document, and the styling which they have mentioned, all the styling you will write it in a text editor. You will save it in a name. Here I have saved in the name mystyleq3.css.css is the extension. You will save it in that. In that CSS file, they will not contain any HTML tags, only the selector and the block declaration you will find in that. So here, my HTML document, that is program PRG6 is the title. Here in the head section, I will have a link tag because the external file which I've created, the name is this, mystyleq3. This I have to attach to my HTML document. So link, REL relationship equal to style sheet, type equal to text bar CSS, href equal to the hypertext reference. I'm giving the file name here, mystyleq3.css. This is the file, and this file contains all the styling which is required. Then in the body, I've given the BG color coral. I tried to use different colors for each web pages so that you will learn the different HTML color codes or names. Here, H1 cascading style sheet. They have mentioned we need a text cascading style sheet. So it is up to you to give the title H1 or H2 or even a paragraph also. It is fine. So I have used H1 here. H1 is cascading style sheet. What is the type of styling required for this? The text should be underlined and green in color. So H1, the selector mentioned in my styleq3 file, H1, the text decoration should be underlined and it should be of color green. So text decoration property, underline value, color property, green value. Now, the next one is you have a paragraph, and the paragraph they have mentioned here, it should have a styling. The styling, it should be Arial black font and a margin of 30 pixels. So paragraph B is a selector, font family Arial black, and margin left of 30 pixels have mentioned here. Now here I have a link. Link should be without underline. Usually if it is an anchor tag, if there is a link, it will be underlined. But I don't want an underline for that. So you have to use a text decoration, none for that, with an outside border and a padding around it. For that, A tag, text decoration, none. Border is outside. It's a 3D outside border. You will get padding of 10 pixels. So here, AHREF. They said you should have a link. The link should be a functional World Wide Web. So here I have mentioned www.mywebpage.com, and I've mentioned click on learn more on SCSS, and I've closed the anchor tag, and you can see the output now. So output cascading style sheet with text decoration. It is underlined and it is green in color. It is H1. Now we have a paragraph. The paragraph is Arial black. The margin is 40 pixels. Margin left is 40 pixels. So here I have the link here. Link does not contain any underline. It does have a border outset with a padding of 10 pixels all around from top, right, bottom and left 10 pixels. So in external style sheet, you have to have the link tag with the URL you have to mention. So you have to create a separate file in a text editor with extension.css, which will contain all the styling which is required. So whatever elements are there in this particular HTML, you will not write the styling inside this document. You will write the styling in a separate file. Students, we have learned types of CSS. We know what a selector is. So now we are going to learn the types of selectors. The types of selectors are ID selector, class selector, universal selector, grouping selector. So what we learned was an element selector. That is, to give a color to a paragraph text, you will use P, braces open, color, colon, red, braces close, where color is a property, red is a value, and P is a tag or element which is used as a selector. So now we will learn these selectors one by one. The first selector, ID selector. The ID selector selects the ID attribute of an HTML element to select a specific element. That is, each element can have only one ID. An ID is used to identify one element. An ID is always unique within the page, so it is a unique element. That is, when you see an ID, you are sure it does not exist anywhere else within the same page. It is written with a hash character followed by the ID name. That is, when you want to create an ID selector name, you start with a hash, this character, and after that you give a name for it. And where do we place it? We place it inside the style tag, and style tag is placed inside the head tag. An ID name cannot start with a number. That is, we cannot use a number immediately after the hash. We can use alphabet after the hash. You can include number also, but not the number cannot be included immediately after the hash. Now, we'll see it with an example. I have an HTML5 program. You can see I have two paragraphs in this body. Now, for these two paragraphs, only for the first paragraph, I want to give a styling. The styling which I want is an oblique style I want, and a text decoration of line through. This is what I want only for the first paragraph. So what I've selected here, it's an ID selector. Now, ID selector is placed inside the style tag, which is placed inside the head part. Okay, so it starts with a hash, and immediately you cannot write a number here. Whichever name you want, you can suggest. Here, the name which I've given is ABC. You can place number also here. Number 0 to 9 we can use, but not immediately after the hash. Now, braces open. So, I've given a font style oblique and a text decoration line through. So, the entire thing. So, this is my ID, the ID selector. Now, in the body, I have two paragraphs. Now, I want only this styling to apply for this paragraph. That is, P I've given, and ID is an attribute. I used it as an attribute. Here, hash I've provided when I named it, but after that, when I provide ID, I cannot write hash here. Hash is written only once. So here, ID equal to, I only write the name here, the ID name, which is ABC. Now, HTML4. Now, this ID, you cannot use it for any other elements. So that is why it is called, it's a unique element, and it is ID is always unique. We'll see the output. In the output, we have HTML4. It has got oblique and a line through. You can see the second para. Second para does not have this kind of styling. So the second para is not affected by the styling because we have applied ID only to the first paragraph. The second type of selector, class selector. The class selector selects HTML elements with a specific class attribute. It means here we are using an attribute called class. The class selector is used when you want to change a group of elements within your HTML page. That is, you can use same class on multiple elements. You can also use multiple classes on the same element. Now, how do we use a class selector? It is used with a period character, that is a full stop symbol, followed by the class name. So in the previous slide for ID selector, you've seen that we have used a hash and then we use the ID name. Here in the case of class selector, we are using a period, that is a full stop symbol, followed by the class name. The class name should not start with a number. You can use alphabets and numbers 0 to 9, but we cannot start with a number immediately after the dot symbol. We'll see it with an example. See, the title is Program 8, that is PRG 8. Here, for the class selector, we have to use the class selector
inside the style tag, and the style will be placed inside the head part. You see the head part is closing over here. Now, how do we use a class selector? The class selector starts with a dot, that is a full stop. Then you can write the name you wish to. So here the name which I've given is choice. Here I've got two class selector. The first one is dot, started with dot, choice, and the second one is dot, my underscore choice. I have two class selectors here. Now see it in the body. In the body, I've got an H2, which is mentioned as class selector, and I've got a paragraph here. Now I want to apply a styling to H2 as well as to paragraph. Now you can see choice has got the property text align center color chocolate, while my underscore choice has got border as dotted. Now here in H2, I've given the class as choice. So here when you write the class choice, see you have mentioned you have used a specific attribute. Class is the attribute used. So here H2, I have to mention class. When you mention class, you will not mention the dot. Dot is mentioned only once. That is, now we will not mention the dot. We have written choice only. Now the class selector, I have mentioned it here. So this class selector will have a color chocolate and it will be aligned to the center. Now I've got a paragraph. The paragraph, again I've mentioned class. Which class I want? I want both the classes. I want choice as well as my choice. So this first paragraph content, it will be of color chocolate. It will be aligned to the center and it will have a border which is dotted. So this means that a particular choice, the choice, this class selector, I can apply to H2 as well as to paragraph. That is, I can apply to multiple elements. That is what a class selector says. Now, for this particular tag P, I have used two class selectors. So how do you use two class selectors? You only have to mention class once, equal to, in double quotes, you will put both the names here separated by a comma. So one element can use multiple class selectors, and this class selector can be used for multiple elements. So I have put both together in the program for you to understand. Now you see the output. In the output, you can see the class selector, which is an H2. It is chocolate in color. It is aligned to the center. I have a paragraph. It is first paragraph. The paragraph is chocolate in color. It is aligned to the center. It also got a border. The border is dotted. Now there's one more thing you have to learn in this. That is, you can also specify that only specific HTML elements should be affected by a class. For that, you have to start with the element name, then with the period character, followed by the name of the class. Now till now, in this program, what we have done, we have started with the dot and we've given a name for the class. Now here what they are saying is, for particular element, that is, suppose I want a paragraph, only for paragraph I want to give a class selector. That is possible. Okay, so we'll see with an example. See, in this, it is written inside the style, which is placed inside the head part. I've got an element P. It has to start with the element name, that is for paragraph, that is P I start, and then with the dot. Dot I've mentioned here. Then I give a name, whichever name you want to mention, and the style which I want is background color pink. Okay. Now here in the body, I have an H1. I have a paragraph. I have two paragraphs here. Okay. So for H1, I'll provide this class. So when you write the class, you have to write the class attribute equal to home. Here, only home you have to write. You don't have to write that dot you will not write. And in this case, even the P you will not write. Okay, only home. And I have a content here. Now for the second item, that is for the first paragraph, you have mentioned here, but I'm not applying the style. I don't want the style. Okay. Now for the second paragraph, I'm applying the style. I have to write class and equal to home. So this particular class selector, I have applied to two things. One is for H1 and the second one is for this para. Now we'll see the output. See, in the output, I'm supposed to have a background color pink. Okay, now though I applied this particular class selector to H1, I did not see the background color pink. So the pink color will not happen for this H1 because it is a selector which is starting with P. That is, this selector can be applied only to paragraphs. Though I have given the name, though I have mentioned the class over here, it will not happen for this H1. To make you understand, I have applied for this. You see, it is not shown in the output. Now, for the first paragraph, I did not apply, so I did not get it. Now, for the last paragraph, see class equal to home. So, the background color, you can see background color pink. So, because this particular thing will happen only for the paragraphs. So, whichever element you want, you can specify that element you write in the beginning. Then followed by the dot, that is a period or a full stop, then you start the name. The third selector, universal selector. The universal selector selects all the elements within the HTML page. That is, if you want to select all the elements in the page, you have to use universal selector. An asterisk, multiplication symbol or a little star is used to denote a CSS universal selector. The asterisk is used for selecting all elements. So how do we write it? The syntax, that is the asterisk, open the braces, you'll write the property and value and close the braces. So we'll see it with an example, HTML5 program, the title is PRG9. You can see the style tag which I've placed inside the head part. And here I've mentioned the universal selector. For the universal selector, you have to use the asterisk. To open the bracelet, then you have to write the property and value. Here the property I've given is here is color and the value given to the color is salmon. You can see in the body, I have an H3 and I have two paragraphs. So I want this H3 and two paragraphs as well as this universal selector for which I haven't given any heading or a paragraph. All these should have color salmon. So we'll see the output. See the output, universal selector, first heading, which is H3, first paragraph, which is paragraph 1, and second paragraph, again the second paragraph, all these have got the color salmon. So how do we write a universal selector? You only have to mention the asterisk and you have to mention the property along with the value. So the entire web page having all the elements will get this particular styling. The fourth selector, grouping selector. The grouping selector is used to select all the elements with the same style definitions. That is, suppose in your web page you have 3 or 4 elements which you want to give same styling. So with grouping selector, you can provide styling to all these elements. It is used to minimize the code. Commas are used to separate each selector and grouping. We'll see it with an example. HTML5 program, the title is PRG10. Here I have mentioned the style tag in the head part. I have used the grouping selector inside the style. So in the body we can see I have H3, H4 and a paragraph and H6. So I want to provide a styling to H3, H4 and paragraph and not to H6. And same styling I want to give to all these 3 elements. So in the style part, in the style tag, what I have to do is for the grouping selector, I have to mention the tag, that is the selector H3. The first is H3, I'll mention H3 here, then H4, I'll mention H4, then the paragraph P. So all these are separated with comma. Then I'll mention the property and the value. I want all these elements to have a color orange and it should be aligned to the right. So grouping selector says that it minimizes the code. How? Here for H3, H4 and for the paragraph I want to give the styling and it's the same styling. So I don't have to write separately class over here for each of these elements. Instead what I can do altogether, write all the selectors over here with the comma and you mention the property and value. This is all you have to do. Now we'll see the output. In the output, I can see the H3, H4 here and the paragraph here.
all are aligned to right and they have the color orange. You can see H6. H6 I did not provide as a selector, so it's not in the group cell grouping selector. So here it is left aligned and doesn't have a color orange. So here H3, H4 paragraph, all on the right hand side with color orange. So grouping selector, how do we do it? You only have to mention the selector with comma separating them, and you mention the property and the value. We have already learned the types of selectors. We'll solve programs on selectors. The first question, create an HTML page to display H1 elements and P elements. Set the first H1 to red color. To display H1 elements and P elements means you should have H1 tags and paragraph tags in your web page. Now H1 tag, when you mention, you have to provide the text for that, and for the paragraph you have to provide the appropriate text for it. Now the number of H1, number of paragraphs you want in your web page, it is up to you to decide. Here it is mentioned set the first H1 to red color. So you should have more than one H1 in your web page. Now if you're just selecting for one element, or you should have a unique element in your web page, which selector will you use? It is going to be a ID selector. Now for the ID selector, you have to use a style tag which will place inside the head part. Now how do you write an ID selector? You have to start with a hash symbol and then you'll mention the ID name. Then braces open, you'll write the property and value. The property here is color, colon, value is red, braces close. In the body, I've got two H1, two paragraphs. Only for H1, I want to provide the style. So here, after writing H1, I'll mention the attribute, which is ID for the ID selector equal to, I'll write the name. When you write the name, you will not mention the hash symbol. Only the change you will write here and my web page, which is a text. Now see the output. In the output, this is the first H1, second H1, first paragraph, second paragraph. Only the first paragraph has got the color red. This is how you do a ID selector. The next question, create an HTML page to display H1 elements and paragraph elements. Set the first H1 element and first paragraph element color to light blue. It means in this program, I have many H1 tags and many paragraph tags. Set the first H1 element and first paragraph element. Only the first H1 element and the first paragraph element should have the color light blue. So when you want to change a group of elements, which selector will you use? It is class selector. Now for the class selector, you have to mention the style tag which you'll place inside the head part. Now how do you write a class selector? Start with the dot or a period, then you write the class name. Then the braces open, you will write the property and value separated by colon. The property here is color, colon, light blue, braces closed. In my body, I have first H1, second H1, first paragraph, second paragraph. For the first paragraph here and for the first H1, what I have to mention is I'll write class. Class is the attribute which we use for the class selector. So after writing H1, class equal to, you'll write in inverted commas, write the class name. So the class name here is select my web page. Here also for the paragraph you have mentioned select. You will not put the dot there. Dot is only when you're naming the class. See the output. The first H1 and the first paragraph, it's in color light blue. The next program, create an HTML page to align all the elements to the center. That is, when you want to select all the elements, which selector will you use? It is universal selector. To mention the universal selector, you have to use the style tag which you place inside the head part. You have to use a symbol, that is a little star sign or the asterisk, and then the braces open, text align, which is a property, colon, value, that is center, braces close. In the body, I've got two H1, two paragraph. I want to give styling to all the elements in the web page. See the output. All the elements in the web page is aligned to the center. Next program. Create an HTML page to align paragraph H2, H6 elements to the center. Now here, I want to select few elements and I want to give same styling to all these elements. that is paragraph H2H6, all elements of paragraph H2H6 should be aligned to the center. So when you want to give same styling to all these elements, that is to minimize the code, which selector will you use? It is grouping selector. For the grouping selector, you have to mention the style which you write inside the head part, PH2H6. Here I will use the element selector, that is we'll write the name of the tag. The name of the tag is paragraph tag. So you'll write P, will not use the angle bracket. Here next is H2, will not use the angle bracket H2. Next is H6. H6 is the tag, we'll write H6 here. They're separated by comma. So this is how you write a grouping selector. Braces open. All three elements should have same styling. So actually we are minimizing the code. Instead of writing P text align center, again next line H2 at text align center, again in next line H6 text align at center, all together we put it in one line. So this is minimizing the code. Now in the body you can see there's an H1. H1 does not have the style. You can see the output, the selector which is H1, which does not have the styling text align center. Rest H2, paragraph and H6 are aligned to the center. So this is what a grouping selector is. The next topic what we are going to learn is positioning in CSS. Now, CSS helps to position the HTML elements. The position property is used to set position for an element. That is, if you want to set position of an element in your web page, you have to use position property. Let's see the syntax. The syntax goes like this. The selector, braces open, you have to mention the position. So position is the property here and you have to mention the value. Then you have top, you mention the value, left value, bottom value, right value. Now the elements are positioned using the top, bottom, left, right properties. So these properties will not work. That is, these top, left, bottom, right properties will not work unless the position property is set first. So you have to mention the position property, then you'll mention the top, left, bottom or right values. So you can see the value in positions are static as default. Here the position static, which is default one, or you can use fixed or absolute or relative. And for the values for top, left, bottom, right, they are mentioned in pixels. We have seen what a position property is, and to position an element we have to use top, right, bottom and left properties with the values. So we'll see how do you move an element using these properties. I'll explain. See, this blue is the browser window and I've got a box which is red in color. This is at top zero, that is at the extreme corner at the top. I want to move this box down, that is I want to move this box 20 pixels down. See how it is done. See, from 20 pixels down means from the top 20 pixels it got shifted. Now my box is over here. So when I say you have to move this element 20 pixels down or 80 pixels down, this is how it is done. We can use negative values also for this. Now this was positive value. For positive value means 20 pixels from the top you are going down towards the bottom. Okay. Now if I want to move this box towards up only, instead of going down you want to move it up. So what you have to give here, you have to give top minus 20 pixels, so it will come back here. Okay. Now we'll see bottom. Bottom, this box is at the zero position, it is down here. I want to move this box towards up. It has to go top 20 pixels. Let's see. See, this has been shifted from here 0 to 20 pixels towards up. Now here also we have used positive values, that is 20 pixels. That 20 pixels means from the bottom you are going towards up 20 pixels. If I want to move it down, what you have to do, you have to write bottom minus 20 pixels, this will come back here. The next we'll see if it is left. Left zero position, that is it's at the zero here at the extreme top left corner. Now I want to move this
20 pixels towards the right. It has to go towards the right 20 pixels. That is from here 20 pixels. Let's see. See, from here, the left, the box was here. From here, shifted 20 pixels towards the right. That is from left 20 pixels. Now, if I want to move this box towards left only using left property, what will I give? I have to give left minus 20 pixels. So, plus 20 pixel will move it, shift it towards the right. Minus 20 pixel will take it towards the left. Now, we'll see. Right, I've got this box at the extreme position, at the zero position. Now, I want to move it towards the left. We'll see that to 20 pixels. See, from 20, from here, I have shifted the box from here towards the left. It is 20 pixels. Now, this is positive value. If I want to move it towards the right only using right property. So, I have to give right minus 20 pixels. So, from here, it will go back over here. We are going to learn types of positioning. So, you know in positioning that you place the elements using the position property. And we use the property top, bottom, right or left and we'll give values in pixels. You know how it is moved from top, this many pixels, how it is moved, you know that. Okay. Now, we learn the different types of positioning which include the first one is static positioning, which is the default one. Second, fixed positioning. Third, absolute positioning. The fourth one, relative positioning, we'll be learning one by one. The first type of positioning, static positioning. This is a by default position for HTML elements. That is, static is a default position for any element on a web page. It is not affected by the top, bottom, left and right properties. That is, if you do not define the position of an element, it is static, which means that it displays on the screen based on where it is in the HTML document and how it displays inside the normal flow of that document. We'll see with an example. To mention a static positioning, we have to use position, the property, static, the value. Here, we have used style tab inside the head part. I have used a class selector, dot .apc, braces open, position, static. Color, cold I've given, border is solid. Students, I wanted to make you understand that position of an element will not change unless you use top, bottom, left and right properties. Here we haven't used top, bottom, left or right properties because if you use it, if you do not use it, the output for the program is going to be the same as it is not affected, as these properties are not affected in the output page. So, in this program, only color and border property will work. See, in body, I've got four paragraphs. For the second paragraph, I've given this class styling. Now, let's see the output. The output, I've got four paragraphs. First paragraph, second, third, and fourth. For the second paragraph, we have given this class ABC. So, it will have a border, which is solid and golden color. This is according to the normal flow of the page. Whatever I've mentioned in the HTML source page, one after the other, it is reflected as it is in the output. There is no change here. This is what a static positioning is. The second positioning, fixed positioning. The fixed property forces an element into a fixed position relative to the browser window. Here, fixed means it always stays in the same place even if the page is scrolled. So, when do we use fixed positioning? If you want something to remain visible at all times on the page, we use this positioning. We can use top, right, bottom, left properties to position the element. The top, bottom, left, right will not work unless the position property is set. So, we have to use position property with value fixed. Then mention the top, bottom, left, right values. Let's see an example.
I have this class selector inside the style tag. See the class selector dot fix. Fix is the name of the class selector. Braces open. Position is the property. Colon fixed is the value. From top 50 pixels. From right 15 pixels. Color is aqua. Braces close. In the body I've got four paragraphs. For the fourth paragraph I've given this class, mentioned the fix. So if this particular paragraph is fixed from the top 50 pixels going towards down and from the right 15 pixels going towards left, and the color will be aqua. Let's see the output. You can see the paragraphs. The first para, second para, third paragraph and the fourth paragraph is over here. So here the fixed position, this is the paragraph which has got the fixed position. The fixed position element are removed from the normal document flow. Here the normal document flow is, it has to be the first para, second para, third para, the fourth paragraph supposed to be here. But I've moved it from here over here, that is from top 50 pixels down and from right 15 pixels I have placed it over here. So that is the position we have given. And the position is fixed, that is it remains visible at all times when you scroll this page. I'll explain that. See this, it's the same program, same output page. Here I have included numbers from 1 to 255 to make you understand. See, this is the first page, this is what it is visible. You can see your text which is fixed positioned on the right hand side in aqua color. Now if you scroll down, I scroll down to the last page, that is 255 number. See the three paragraphs which were there on the left hand side, it is not visible anymore. But this text which is fixed position, it remains there. So it means it is fixed when you scroll down the page. That is what a fixed position is. The third positioning, absolute positioning. This property sets an element in specific location and it is not affected by the flow of the page. That is, absolute positioning allows you to literally place any page element exactly where you want it. This property positions the element at the specified coordinates relative to your screen top left corner. Here we can use top, right, bottom, left properties to position the element. The position the element may overlap each other. And also remember students, this is related to your screen top left corner. Now remember this point. If your absolute position element has no positioned ancestor, then it uses the document body. Here it's related to screen top left corner and moves along with page scrolling. We'll explain with an example. HTML5 program, meta tag, name equal to keywords, content is absolute position. I've got the style tag which is placed inside the head part. H2 is my selector. I have given position absolute. This is how you write position absolute. Position is a property, absolute is a value. The position absolute values, to position it, I've given left 75 pixels, top 150 pixels, width, height and background color given. In the body, I have H1, H2 and paragraph. So this styling is only applied to H2 for this. Now let's see the output. Here the position property, that is H1. First paragraph, that was the paragraph, the last paragraph. The second item in the flow of the document was this H2. But it is not placed over here, it is placed over here. See, because I've given position absolute and the value which I've given is left 75 pixels. You can see that is from the screen top left corner, 75 pixels from the left, from top 150 pixels, from top 150 pixels, it's over here. So it's not affected by the flow of the page. The flow of the page, the H2 was supposed to be here, but I have used position absolute to place wherever I want. Now we'll see here if at all I change the top position. Now see, the top position is 50 pixels now. See, earlier it was 150 pixels, it was my H2 was here. Now it is 50 pixels, my H2 is here and is overlapping this paragraph. So this is how it is placed. The left is same 75 pixels. So this is related to screen top left corner.
Now here we have used only positive values. Now if we use negative values, we'll see the left is minus 15 pixels. Absolute position, we'll see. My first H1 as it is, the paragraph, the last paragraph. Now we can see here the last paragraph. Now my H2 which was in the middle, but here the left is minus 15 pixels. Minus 15 pixels means from the left I'm going towards the left. So this is the heading. I can't even see the T now because it's shifted towards the left. And top, it's 100 pixels from the top. So this is how it is placed. Students, this is to make you understand what is relative to ancestor or parent. This is not mentioned in the text, so you don't have to worry about it. Now, position absolute. An element with position absolute is positioned relative to the nearest position ancestor. That is, if the absolute position element has no positioned ancestor, then it uses the document body. In the previous slide, we have seen that we have used the document body, that is the screen top left corner, to place the elements. Now here, you see the first box, the dotted red box, that is the parent. I have given the position relative to this box. Now in the inside box, the blue box, I have given position absolute. Now this box can be placed anywhere inside or outside related to this particular box. Okay, so it will not use the document body, it will use relative to this box. Now here I've given top 0 pixels and right 0 pixels. So this box has shifted over here. So this is 0 pixel and right 0 pixel relative to this red box. Now here you can see it's the same program and the same output. This blue box I have given top 20 pixels, right 20 pixels. So related to this particular box, 20 pixels down, that is from top 20 pixels, and from right 20 pixels this box is placed. So this is what an absolute is. This is relative to the ancestor. Here this is the child and this is the parent here. So according to the ancestor, it will be relative and you can position this element according to that. The fourth positioning, relative positioning. The relative positioning property is to set the element relative to its normal position. It means to position an element based on its current position without changing the layout. Setting the top, right, bottom, left properties of a relatively positioned element will cause it to be adjusted away from its normal position. Now, how do we write relative positioning? You have to use the property position. Relative is the value. You can set top, left, right, and bottom values for it. We'll see it with an example. HTML5 program. I've used a meta tag. What is meta tag? It is to provide information about the web page. It is placed in the head part. Charset is an attribute. UTF-8 is a value for charset. It is for Indian characters. I have the style tag placed inside the head section. Here B is the selector I've used, bold. I've given position relative. This is how you write. Position is the property, relative is the value. From top 25 pixels, left 15 pixels. So this is according to the normal position of that particular element. Background color I've given is plum. In the body, I've got just one paragraph. HSC bold, standard 12, IT. Now for standard 12 is bold. So I want this, it is position as relative. That is standard 12 is relative positioning. From top 25 pixels, left 15 pixels. Let's see the output. If at all I haven't given any position relative, this is the normal output for the paragraph. Okay, just the normal output with the color plum. Now I've given position relative. So this is my origin point. This is what they say normal position. My normal position is this. My standard 12 is supposed to be here. So in this one, in this output, I've given the position relative. So this is supposed, standard 12 is supposed to be here. Now from here, 25 pixels top. That is, top means from going from top to down. From here to down, going down 25 pixels. And left 15 pixels from this origin point. This is the origin point. 15 pixels towards the right. Now this is where the standard 12 will be placed. So this is what position relative is. It is related to its normal position. The standard 12 is supposed to be here. Okay, now I got it here. In this case, it is just like top is 0 pixels and left is 0 pixel. That is what standard 12 here. I haven't mentioned any position relative in this output. Here, the position relative is mentioned. Now we'll see. In this, we have mentioned only plus values. Now, if you give negative values, here top is 25 pixels again, but left is minus 75 pixels. We'll see the output. HSE board standard 12 supposed to be here. So this is the origin point. Now from here down 25 pixels, left. Left I've given minus, it will go towards the left. If I give left plus 25, or just if I mention 75, means from left, this origin point, it will go towards the right. But here it is minus, it means it's going towards the left. So it is on the left hand side. You can see here, this is minus 75 and it is 25 pixels. So where is the origin point? This is the origin point. This is what it says. It's relative to its normal positioning. Normal positioning, standard 12 is supposed to be here. Now from here, you are moving down and towards the left.
We have learned the types of positioning. We'll solve programs on positioning. Since static is the default one, I haven't included static program here. We'll see the rest. The first one, write HTML code to position B element 100 pixels from top, 50 pixels from right, relative to its browser window. So since it is relative to its browser window, we have to use fixed positioning and we have to position this B element. For that, in the style tag, which is placed inside the head part, we have to use the element selector B, braces open, position, which is a property, colon, fixed is the value for fixed positioning. Now, 100 pixels from top, that is 100 pixels from top going down, top, colon, 100 pixels, property, value. From right, 50 pixels, that is from right, 50 pixels going towards left, right, colon 50 pixels, property, value, braces closed. In the body, you can see the paragraph with the text. See the output. The paragraph text is placed 100 pixels from top and 50 pixels from right. It is placed over here. Now, since it's a fixed positioning, it means that it remains fixed when you scroll the page. I will see the next one. The second one, write HTML code to position H5 element 120 pixels from top and 5 pixels left relative to its document body. So if it is relative to its document body, it means it's an absolute positioning. We have to position this H5 element. For that, in the style tag, we'll mention the element. Here it is H5. We'll mention the element selector H5. Braces open. The property is position. Colon, absolute is the value for absolute positioning. 120 pixels from top, that is from top 120 pixels going towards bottom, 5 pixels left. They did not mention 5 pixels from left. Instead, they said 5 pixels left, that is using the left property itself, you are going towards left 5 pixels. So you have to mention left minus 5 pixels, braces closed. In the body, you can see the H5 text. See the output, the H5 text, my heading, it's placed 120 pixels from top and minus 5 pixels, it's going towards left. Even the M is is not visible properly. If it is absolute positioning, you can keep the text anywhere you want and it is not affected by the document flow. We'll see the next one. Third program, write HTML code to position H3 element 20 pixels down, 10 pixels right, relative to its normal position. If it is related to its normal position, it is relative positioning. We have to position this H3 element. For that, in the style tag, we have to use the element which is H3, braces open, position, that is a property, colon, relative is the value for the relative positioning. Now here, they did not mention 20 pixel top. Instead, they said 20 pixels down. So down is not a property. So it means you are going 20 pixels down. So if you're going down, definitely what they meant was 20 pixels from top, you're going down. So you have to mention top 20 pixels. Now 10 pixels right. It means you are going towards right from your origin position towards right 10 pixels using the right property. So here you have to use right minus 10 pixels. If it was right plus 10 pixels, they should mention 10 pixels from right. They did not mention from right. Race is closed. You can see H3 text in the body. See the output. My heading, which is my H3, it is placed 20 pixels from top. Okay. And from right, 10 pixels, minus 10 pixels, which is going towards right. If the positioning top and right was not there, it will be here. The position will be here. Why? This is the normal positioning. So its relative positioning means it is relative to its normal position. So normal position would be here. My heading would be here. Instead, we moved it 20 pixels down. So again, we came here. Then right minus 10 pixels. So it should be here. So we are going towards right itself. Minus means you're going towards right. So from here, it shifted 10 pixels here. So from the origin point, which was supposed to be here, we shifted the same text down by 20 pixels and right by minus 10 pixels. After positioning in CSS, we are going to learn two properties. The first one, float property. The float property defines the flow of content. The float property specifies how an element should float. So why do we use a float property? The elements mentioned after a floating element will flow around it. The values used are none, which is the default one, left or right. So how do we write it? You'll mention the property float colon, you'll mention left or right. If it is left, the element floats to the left of its container. If it is right, the element floats to the right of its container. We'll see it with an example. I have this HTML5 program, in which I've mentioned meta tag. Meta, the name is description. The content is float property. Here I've got the style tag, which is placed inside the head section. I've got two class selectors. The first one is dot mystyle1. The second one dot mystyle2. In mystyle1, I've given float left. And mystyle2, I have given float right. In both the class selectors, I've given background color gold. Now, body BG color given is violet. I've got an H2, which is information. The class given here is myStyle1. So that is, this information will have the property float, which is left, and background color gold. Then I've got a paragraph. Again, I have an H2. The class is myStyle2. That is, it will have a background color gold and the float property right. The content is technology. Then I've got a paragraph. We'll see the output. The output, you see the information, which is H2. The background color is gold and float left. That is, it is to the left hand side. Then I've got the content, that is paragraph. This paragraph element, you can see it's floating around this element. Now I've got H2, which is technology, which is float right. So it will be on the right hand side. And the element which is following after the H2, which is a paragraph, this will float around this element. So whichever element is after the element in which the float property is mentioned, it will float around it. So you can see here, you must have noticed that while reading books, where the first letter in a paragraph has a bigger font size and rests all the lines in the paragraph floating around it. See, this letter is big and the rest of the lines are floating around it. This is what a float property looks like. Now you must be thinking, why not use a text align? Because text align has got values left, right, we have center and justified. I'll show you the difference. It's the same program. Instead of float, I have used text align. For the information, float, instead of float left, I have used text align left. Instead of technology for the right, I have used text align right. We'll see the difference. See, information, then the paragraph, technology, then the paragraph. Here, text align is to place or arrange some content in a straight line. So this is in a structured manner. While in float, float can move the element left or right and can make the following element float around it.
So this float left, the following element is paragraph, it's floating around it. Now technology, which is at the right, float right, and the paragraph after that, it's floating around it. So this is the difference between text line and float. I hope you understood float property.
The second property is display property. Display property in CSS specifies how the elements are displayed. The elements here are paragraph, hyperlink, footer, header, form, heading, etc. The values for display property are inline, block, inline block, none. We will see each of these values one by one with an example. The first program here, I've used display property with value inline. So what is display inline? This property is used to display an element as an inline element, that is on the same line. Here the height and width properties are not affected. Now students, remember, an inline element does not start on a new line and only takes as much width as necessary. Here, got the style tag which placed inside the head section. The selector is P, that is paragraph. Display property, inline is the value. I have given a background color yellow. The body, I have given a peachy color, apple green. I have got two paragraphs. The first para is display property, the second para is using inline. So I want these two paragraphs to be displayed as inline and with a background color yellow. Let's see the output. See the output, display property, first paragraph, second paragraph using inline. So usually when you write a paragraph, the second paragraph should come in the next line. Here both the paragraphs are in the same line. So this is what display inline means. And you can see the background color yellow. So the width of the background color yellow, you see how much of it is required, only that much color it is shown here. So this is what an display inline is. Now we'll see block. Here display block means displays an element as a block element like paragraph. It starts on a new line and take up full width of the browser window. Here you can see the style tag placed inside the head section. I have the selector B, that is bold. Display is a property, block is the value. I've given color and background color. In the body, I've got an H1 and I've got two paragraphs. In the first paragraph, I've mentioned bold twice, first for paragraph and second for display. This means whatever mentioned in bold, that is using the selector, this paragraph and display should be displayed as block. Now let's see the output. Display property, that's a H1. Now we can see the second paragraph here, as it is mentioned. In the first paragraph, you can see the paragraph and the display, it is separated from the first line. See, the first line, this paragraph is supposed to come in the first line. But this is a display block, so it will take up a new line. So it's in the new line. Using cannot come in the same line because this is a block. Block will create a new line. So this display, again, this display is a display block. See, this is display block. Now the next block, again, it cannot come in the same line because this is a block and this is a part of paragraph. So you can see, using a display block, you are creating a new line for wherever you've mentioned display block. And it will take up full width of the browser window. You can see the full width. The color which I've given is tomato. See, it's full width. Now the third one is inline block. Inline block appears the same as inline, but we can apply height and width values. In inline, we cannot apply height and width, but in inline block you can apply height and width. You can see the program. Style tag, inside the style tag I have the selector, which is a paragraph. I've mentioned display inline block, two words, hyphen in between, color I've given, background color I've given here width 25% and height 60 pixels. In the body you can see there's an H1 and I've got two paragraphs. So I want both the paragraphs to be displayed as inline block. Now we'll see the output. This is display property, which is H1. This is my first paragraph and this is my second paragraph. Though they are paragraphs, it will not come in separate line because I've mentioned inline block. And I have used the width. See, the width is 25%, height is 60 pixels. So I can mention height and width using inline block. The next one is none. Display none. Setting the display property to none, we can hide an element and the page will be displayed as if the element is not there or removed. You can see here in the style tag placed inside the head section, my selector is H1 and I've mentioned display none. The body PG color is slate. I've got an H1 and I've got two paragraphs. We'll see the output. Here, first paragraph it's mentioned here. Second paragraph it's displayed here. But I cannot see the H1. H1 is not visible here. So the page is displayed as if H1 is not there. Why? Because I've mentioned here H1, display none. So it will behave as if H1 is removed. So we studied all the four values in line, block, inline block and none. Students, now you have to solve these programs. To solve these three programs, you have to be thorough with CSS properties, values and types of CSS. Wherever you see H1, paragraph, H2 elements, you have to use a respective tag with the text. Now for these four programs, you should be thorough in types of selectors. I have given a hint. See here. In each question, so you can use the correct selector with that feature. But you will not get these hints in exam. I have mentioned the hints as you will be solving CSS selector exercises for the first time and it gives you a clear picture about the selector. To sort these three programs, you have to be thorough in positioning in CSS. Since static is a default one, I haven't given a question on it. You don't have to write any extra properties. Whatever properties and values given in the question, mention that in the program. To solve this program, you should know float and display property. Here the CSS output is given. You should write HTML code for it.